here, a night on the town means drinks, dinner, dancing. At least it did until the kids, the job, the mortgage, turning 40, the 401k. So when the sun goes down in Beijing, where do the young and the young at heart go to play? In this episode, sample Chinese delicacies at this 400-foot-long buffet. Then chill at the world of Susie Wong or Buffalo Club. You could also unwind with some classical music. Finally, nighttime fun at Lao She Tea House, where Peking Opera and Kung Fu share the same stage. All coming up on Beijing Are You Ready?
Think of Beijing's night market as a 400-foot walking buffet, where you'll find exotic snacks like squid, starfish on a stick, and fried scorpion, made to order right on the spot.
The night market is off the northern entrance to Wang Fu Jin Street in the heart of downtown. And the vendors are quick to rev up their grills and woks the moment the sun even thinks of setting.
Oh, look at this one. See how pretty that is? They don't just put the food in the pot, they actually decorate the pot. It's beautiful. Look, look, it's a Chinese hamburger. This is a Chinese hamburger. They're delicious, they really are good. It's now time to talk about bugs. This is a centipede. I think that's a snake, no skin. Another worm is right there.
Locals snake their way through the crowds. They pick and choose their treats by sight, smell, or just the advertising flair of the vendors, who won't hesitate to change languages to lure a customer to the stall.
In San Francisco, you can get fresh crab on Fisherman's Wharf. In Beijing, right here at the night market. This is beautiful. I'm having some chow mein. Chow mein. That's good. Okay. Let's see. Hao chi. That's how you say good food. Oh, snake. Do you like this? Hao chi.
The county fair atmosphere is made even more lively by the lack of seating. People either snack standing up or while window shopping for their next bite. And the more exotic tidbits aren't just food, they're entertainment.
I've read about fried scorpion. My friends have told me that it's good for your skin, so let's go see if we can find some. I don't see any over there. This booth's got several spidery looking things. Here's one right here. This is it. It's not fried yet. They'll fry it for me. You have the fried scorpion? I've never eaten a spider intentionally in my life, so. What's he doing? Oh, it is alive. He's taking live scorpions and putting them on the stick. He's picking them up with a tweezer and literally just threading them right there on the stick. Look at, they're moving. Poor guys, they're gonna. And now there's some salt going on there and it's time to try it. Thank you. Oh, it's good. Seriously, good.
Is it real?
It's crunchy and salty.
Really?
Yeah, it's good. You want to bite? No, it's good. It's like a French fry. It's good.
Not everybody can win a medal at the Olympics, but everyone can go home with bug-eating bragging rights. Every friendly dare draws a small audience, and the adventurous spirit is contagious.
Do you know what this is?
Seahorse.
It's a seahorse. That was right. That's a seahorse.
Only one.
Poor seahorse.
Another one.
Do you cook it?
That's fried.
Are they fried the seahorse?
What?
And thank you, Shishini. All right. I feel kind of guilty eating a seahorse, but here we go. Mmm. It's really crunchy. I like the texture, but I'm not crazy about the taste because it's kind of fishy. I'll try it one more time because sometimes you have to try two bites and maybe it tastes better next time. No, I don't like it. I don't recommend it. No. I feel that it's my duty to warn my fellow travelers, don't eat the seahorse. It's not so good.
It was a seahorse?
Yes, seahorse. Where are you from?
From Slovenia.
Slovenia?
Slovenia.
Oh, wow. Why did you come to Beijing?
To try seahorse.
Oh, no, you didn't. Go home. Go home.
We're going there, yeah.
Oh, look at this. It's candy-coated fruit. So it's dessert without guilt because you've got your fruit and just a little bit of candy on top. Okay, this has pineapple and strawberries and candy. That, oh, God. That gets the seahorse out of my mouth. That is so good. Mm. This is so good. Come to China to eat this. You only need one reason. This is the reason. Oh, this is so good. The three things that make it worth it to go to the night market are, number one, the people. Everybody here's friendly. Everybody, well, we're all having dinner together. I guess they would be. Secondly, exotic food. It's a place to try something you've never, ever tried before that you've never even thought about trying. And the third reason to go is because this is where people who really are from Beijing, who really are from China, gather. And you can tell because they're speaking to each other, they're waving to each other, they're bumping into each other. This is the real China. Here at the night market, my food horizon has been broadened. There is nothing that's not edible. After eating your fill of Chinese delicacies, why not work off some of that new poundage by dancing the night away? Jump into a cab and make your way to the world of Suzy Wong. Hands down, the grand dame of Beijing's budding nightclub scene is the world of Suzy Wong, located behind an unassuming doorway in the Chaoyang district. A quick flight of stairs, however, leads you into a different world. One that elegantly blends the grandeur of old Hong Kong with thumping techno music. You didn't expect to see Halloween ghosts and goblins in China? At Suzy Wong's, theme nights are just another excuse for what the owner calls a party.
Every night, every evening is a party in Suzy Wong. That's why we
don't really
make any special party, like other clubs, every party, every week. But we just do like a low profile because we have already a lot of people and we want the best crowd.
Right.
Not just anybody come in here, we don't want them.
Blending the best of different cultures is second nature to Anson Jiang, the man behind this popular night spot.
Actually, we are coming up like next early year, we have a gym's night, gymnastic.
Oh.
Yeah. We have all kind of film for parties.
But even ambitious Anson has his sights set pretty high for 2008.
Sure, we provide to an evening only for the athletes after the game. So because they are all international famous athletes.
Of course.
So we want to have, keep their privacy enclosed. And no reporter, no photo, just really have fun for them to relax. They're definitely relaxed after the game because they have prepared for how many years?
Right.
Named after a movie filmed in 1960, this lavish setting is where the beautiful people of Beijing come to play. The bar, the loft, and the private alcoves teem with expats and natives in high fashion and higher spirits. Anson's clientele play board games, sip drinks that would be at home in any U.S. nightclub, take Latino dance classes, enjoy videos on widescreen TVs, and after the DJ shows up, never before 10:30, they can groove to Latin or vocal house, funky groove, progressive or breakbeat music, until 3 or 4 in the morning. Anson has one more plan for making his club even more inviting and more exclusive. Let's review. beautiful people, a party every night, high cover charges, and even Olympic athletes. In August of 2008, that dream may become a reality, especially if Anson Jeong has anything to do with it.
We can host a party for these great people.
Yes, well, I
wish I could do it.
It sounds like already you are thinking about it.
If you want to end your nighttime fun a little closer to Tiananmen Square and have more bars to hop between, a good place to start is Buffalo Club. Buffalo Club sits on Bar Street, just off the shore of Beijing's Rear Lake. Outside the club, red and orange lanterns hanging from the bars and restaurants barely illuminate the sidewalk. Inside the club, the lighting is a different story. Hundreds of candles provide most of the light, giving the restaurant and its customers a warm glow. A quick tour of the place reveals a surprising mix of cultures. The decor is decidedly Southeast Asian, while the large wine rack, full of red wine, screams Napa Valley. Musicians play classical music as you dine. Later, this tiny dance floor will groove to the sound of Cuban music. Downstairs, a romantic private room seats 18 around a wave-filled reflecting pool. This glittering gem of a club, like its neighbors, is relatively new. Rear Lake's Bar Street isn't even 10 years old. During the SARS epidemic, cooped-up Beijingers began to take walks along the empty lakeside. One bar opened up in response to the increased foot traffic, and then another and another. That's how this end of Rear Lake came to be known as Bar Street. Not every establishment here is as quiet and low-key as Buffalo Club. A stroll down the wide sidewalk leads you past pubs featuring live rock bands and bottles of beer, as well as dance clubs virtually vibrating with bassy techno. You'll even find a Starbucks at one end of the street, providing clubbers with a caffeine boost as they wander around the lakeside, trying to decide where to go first. The waterfront fills with locals and tourists looking for dinner, drinks, and dancing, the universal elements of a great night on the town. On the other hand, your brand of nighttime fun might be of the sit-down variety.
Why not take a break from the Olympic action with a little high culture? If classical music is your cup of tea, the China Philharmonic Orchestra plays over 80 concerts a year. You might hear the sounds of Beethoven, Brahms, Copland, even Gershwin, located minutes away from Tiananmen Square.
Founded in 2000 by China's Radio, Film, and Television Bureau, this 120-person orchestra didn't take long to find its footing in the classical music scene. By its fifth season, the symphony had one world tour under its belt and regularly thrills audiences at the Forbidden City Concert Hall on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday evenings. You'll feel right at home here because the program is in both Chinese and English. Performances frequently feature internationally renowned talent like Korean violinist Chi Yung Kim. It's easy to see why Chi Yung travels the world performing and recording the classics. Her flawless technique, beautiful tone, and obvious passion have made her a favorite with everyone from Beijing locals to U.S. presidents. In this piece, Violin Concerto No. 3 in B minor, Opus 61, Chi Yung is led by the able baton of American guest conductor Michael Stern. If the name sounds familiar, you're right. His father is the late violinist Isaac Stern. Like Chi Yung, Michael travels the world making music. So why would China patronize a Western art form when its own musical heritage is so rich and so different from ours? It seems that parents are the same no matter what country they live in. Chinese moms and dads also believe that learning to play a Western musical instrument helps ensure their kid grows up to be a success. With proof like Michael Stern and Chi-Yun Kim, there's not much room for disagreement. So, when you attend the Olympics, earn some proudness points with your parents, no matter how old you are. Oh, and don't worry about what to pack. Although the dress code is semi-formal, if you leave the Vera Wang at home, urban chic will work just fine. The China Philharmonic Orchestra is also getting into the Olympic spirit. They're creating a program inspired by the Beijing Games, which could be a unique opportunity to introduce traditional Chinese instruments to an international audience. What will the final score look like? We'll have to wait till 2008 to find out. If you want a window into Chinese culture, the intriguing Laosha Tea House is a must-see for visitors. The Laosha Tea House opened in 1988 and has been called the cultural link between China's past and its present. Inside, you'll find ancient tea ceremonies, shadow puppetry, Peking opera with English subtitles, Chinese acrobats and magicians, and of course, you will drink lots of fabulous tea. Let's check it out. This nighttime hotspot started as a tea cart on the southern edge of Beijing's Tiananmen Square. Now it's a cultural showcase that seats up to 100 people, a place where foreigners rub shoulders with locals. Sip tea while you enjoy the show, and enjoy snacks like dried plums, pastries, and steamed buns. It's right before the show. Let's sneak backstage, or actually backstage and then on stage, and you can see that they're putting the last minute touches on the tea demonstration. There's the curtain. It'll be opening, I would say, in about 10 minutes, so we got to get out of here in a minute, but this is where they'll do the ancient tea demonstration. Just in case you don't know where to start, you'll get a lesson in brewing tea from the professionals. In Gong Fu Tea, performers use gentle hand movements to produce different kinds of tea. Oh, wow. Xu Xianyi, that was fantastic. You know I love tea, but now I'm going to insist it's served that way every time. Tea pouring is not the only trick you'll see at the Laosha Tea House. There are variety acts throughout the evening. Tea houses are an integral part of Chinese culture. They've been around since the 7th century Tang Dynasty, when storytellers and folk singers were often hired to liven up the atmosphere. And at Laosha, there's lots more to come. The Laosha Tea House marks the revival of tea house culture in Beijing. Named after a Chinese author, it has roots in China's Cultural Revolution, when tea houses were shut down. In 1979, there were some 400,000 young people out of work. Many of them had returned from the countryside, where they'd been re-educated, taught to worship Chairman Mao and his teachings. Meanwhile, a government worker named Yin Shengxi was concerned about unemployment, and he set up an open-air tea stand that provided work for a number of the jobless youth. After the Cultural Revolution ended, that extremely successful tea stand moved to its present dwelling and began featuring the art and culture that had been banned for years. The first floor, left of the main entrance, features dinner and shadow puppetry. Prices are quite reasonable, starting at about $1.50 for hors d'oeuvres and $5 for the show. The second level contains the main gift shop, with tea sets, cups, and naturally, teas galore. Prices are reasonable, so if you really want something special, get some flower tea. Not only is it exotic and beautiful, it's supposed to contain healing ingredients used in traditional Chinese medicine. The second floor is also a VIP area. It's arranged like a traditional Chinese home, called a siheyuan, complete with narrow stone walkways, a surprising grass courtyard, and there are rooms on each side of the courtyard.
This room is beautiful. It's actually kind of modern.
The six rooms seat between 4 and 10 people, but differ greatly in price, mood, and decor. Themes range from ancient Chinese masks to the history of the tea business in the Middle Kingdom. These private rooms host business meetings or are just a place to relax, and they range in price from about $7 to $20 an hour, not including tea and snacks. The third floor is where the party really starts. The large lantern festoon room faces a stage, and the seats fill up quickly. Tea and snacks are provided for a fee, along with the good humor of the master of ceremonies.
In Chinese, this says no access, but we have a backstage pass. When you see these operas, you wonder how the makeup is done and how long it takes and how many people it takes. And right now we're good 45 minutes into what we've seen so far. I'd say she's at least an hour into this. The jewels have gone on, and like I said, no hairpins at all in this whole hairpiece. Maybe we ought to leave her alone so she can meditate and get ready for the show.
One of tonight's performances will be The Legend of Whitesnake, a Peking opera. Even though there'll be subtitles, it doesn't hurt to know that the main character, a white snake, turns itself into a beautiful woman and marries a mortal man. After a ferocious battle, the happy couple is split up by an evil abbot. Sadly, Whitesnake is imprisoned for hundreds of years, but ultimately she triumphs, destroying her prison. Like any good story, Whitesnake has something for everyone. Great costumes, love scenes, and fantastic fights. On to the Kung Fu demonstration. This Chinese martial art is simultaneously a spiritual and a physical discipline. It's been practiced for thousands of years, and many of its movements are imitations of the fighting styles of animals. But self-discipline is emphasized, and you won't find much of that in the animal kingdom. Ouch, that's gotta hurt. The audience also gets involved at Laosha Tea House. Olympic visitors who come to Beijing to see the best of the world's athletes shouldn't miss seeing the best of China's culture and traditions, its legendary hospitality, amazing martial arts, and mesmerizing entertainment. For that and more, the Lausche Tea House provides one-stop shopping.
Are you getting the same impression as I am that Beijing may have more nighttime fun than America? Well, that's it for this episode, and here's a look at what's coming up on the next Beijing. Are you ready?
On the next episode, see why Beijing's old Pipe Street attracts non-smokers from all over the world. Then, take a step back in time on Liu Lichang Street, where art's been sold for hundreds of years. And sharpen your bargaining skills at Yashou, where you can score a big load of goodies even if your budget is tiny. That and more coming your way on the next Beijing Are You Ready?
Thanks for watching. I'm Mary Windischar from the Beijing Night Market. I'll see you next time. More Scorpion.
One more, we should come together.